because without that, none of them would be here.
Right.
That's a beautiful song that we don't sing very much anymore. The girls are going to do their cardboard testimony for y'all in a few minutes. And this morning, our preacher preached out of Ephesians, and it was about being different. And I was trying to make notes. They quit giving us the little points on the screen, so you have to think it up yourself. But one of the things that he said right off the bat was, your manner of life should be different. And it should be. The way we live should be different than everybody else in the world. And what we think on, and I harp at this with the girls, what we put inside of us, the TV we watch, the music we listen to, the books we read, that's what we're going to be. That's what we're going to think. Some of them get mad at me when we won't let them watch all kinds of stuff on the TV. But I got, the other night we got home from Celebrate Recovery, and I was in my room doing some things, and I heard singing. And I thought, oh my, better go investigate that. Make sure nothing's going on with the children. Although it sounded like praise songs. And I went down, and sure enough, they had commandeered the TV, and I guess it was on YouTube. I don't know what they were watching, but it was the videos of all these songs we listened to on Caleb. And they were just having a party, singing praises to Jesus.
Yes.
Thank you. Stand apart.
We've all been delivered from something. Every one of us. If we've been saved, we're delivered from a sin nature. We don't have to live like that. We don't have to give in to sin. One of the verses that the girls in the jail tell a lot, I hear it even, you know, in Bible studies, that, you know, God's not going to put anything more on us than what we can stand. Well, I'm here to tell y'all we can stand anything because we got the Holy Spirit living inside of us.
Amen.
I've always thought it was kind of humorous. I have kind of a skewed concept maybe of God. You know, I could just see him sitting up there just going, oh no, she's got more than she can take. What have I done? No. He's just going to keep heating up the fire. Because what I know, it's like the silversmith. Y'all heard that story. You know, he keeps firing up the silver until all the impurities come to the top, scoops it off, fires it up again, scoops it off. As many times as it takes for him to look down in that and see his reflection. That's what I want God to do in my life. I want him to just get it all out, all gone, until he can look down and say, she looks just like me.
Amen.
Isn't that great? We can look just like him. The Bible says that we're to be conformed to the image of his son. And that's what I want in my life. I want to look just like Jesus. And that's what I want in their life. I want them to look just like Jesus. I have five that actually wanted to tell their stories, not just on the cardboard. So I'm gonna let them do that tonight. I'm very tickled that they were willing to. I will just tell you just a little bit. I mean, a lot of you have heard me talk before, so I'm not going to bore you. But I did grow up in a good home. We grew up at Bellevue Baptist Church. We had a mother and a daddy that loved Jesus and lived that out in front of us. I sat under Dr. Lee and Dr. Pollard and Dr. Rogers. I was gone when Steve Gaines got there, but I've had wonderful pastors in my life. I've had wonderful Sunday school teachers, training union leaders, and GA leaders, and very, very blessed. And a lot of y'all have been too, but not everybody is. About 15 years ago, I got the opportunity to go to jail. And my first thought was, what in the world am I going to do at the jail? I don't know anything about any of that. But I knew that's what I was supposed to do, and I went. And the very first night that I was there, I walked into a room. There was about 35 of them just sitting all around the floor and the wall in little pink jumpsuits. And I thought, my goodness, they look just like my daughter. They just need a bow in their hair. Sitting there all dressed out pink. It just did something to my heart. And I told those girls, and I still tell them to this day, that you are precious to me and precious to God, even in those pink jumpsuits. Don't let that define you. Don't let you think that that's who you are, because it's not. And it's not. I'm that God sent me to jail. Never had handcuffs on. Never been locked up because I had to be. Just locked up because I wanted to be. I'm like Paul, I'm in chains for Christ. And that's what it's all about. Which one of y'all is going first? Suzanne. This is our little Suzanne. And I looked at her and I said, are you a doctor? she's been adopted into the family of God.
Amen.
So she is.
Well, first of all, thank you for letting me come out tonight and share a little bit of my testimony. And thank you for my sisters coming out and supporting me, as well as Ms. Ann. So, here I go. My name is Suzanne Morrison. I'm a great, faithful, and grateful believer in Jesus Christ. I'm 37 years old, born March 28th, 1986. Originally from Chicago, Illinois, but moved to Memphis, Tennessee, and have lived there most of my life. My life growing up wasn't always easy. I was very rebellious and selfish. I liked to party a lot and wasn't taking care of my responsibilities. I've suffered losses and been through a lot of trauma. My greatest loss was April of 2023. I lost my best friend to addiction. Mm-hmm. I woke up and he didn't. It's been the most traumatic thing I've been through. After losing my best friend, I knew the chaos had to stop. That's when I found Miss Ann, precious and pink. Since being in recovery, I've found Christ, been saved and baptized. I pray, read my daily devotional, talk with God on a daily basis, and write in my prayer and praise journal. All these things encourage me, and I grow closer with God every day. I'm thankful and grateful for all the peace and joy He's brought in my life. It's been a long, hard road, but I know I've got the love of God and know I'm not alone. He's been so gracious, and His mercy never ends. I hope to share my story to those around the world someday. 1 Corinthians 13, 4-7 reads, "Love is patient and kind. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. It does not demand its own way. It is not irritable and keeps no record of wrongs. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails." This is Jesus' love, and we should always love like Him. Now I have a poem I would like to share with you all that I wrote. It's called Lost and Found. "I knew you from a young age, because my family raised me well, who knew I'd go astray on a road leading straight to hell. I went to church as a little girl. My parents taught me right from wrong. I was blessed with a loving family. Their love made me strong. Then in my later teens, I turned away from you. I was chasing after this world, clinging to a worldly view. Trauma happened in my life because I was living in sin, caught up in all the world, which ended up taking my friend. Losing him opened my eyes and made me see things in a new light. I needed your help, because without you, I couldn't fight. The devil had me in shackles. In my own mind, I was bound. But you pulled me out of the darkness. I was lost, but now I'm found."
Hi everybody, my name is Laura. A lot of you know my story, and I just want to tell you that how blessed I have been this year since the last time I was there. I was born and raised in Boston, and I was raised Catholic. So I always believed in God, but I never had a relationship with Jesus. So, I never had a relationship with Jesus. In February 2019, I was saved and I was baptized. 1 month later, I went to prison. I went to prison for a year. The whole time I was in prison, my Sunday school and my church prayed for me. And I knew at that point that I had God. And I studied my Bible. I got closer to Him. When I got out of prison, Miss Ann came and picked me up. I stayed with her for 3 years. Mm-hmm. I stayed with her for so long because I had goals. I needed to pay my probation. I didn't have a license for 12 years. It was very, very important for me to get a license. I got a job at City Hall Cheesecake, still there today. Come and see me. And the job was ordained. I finally got my license. I moved out of Miss Ann's house 7 months ago. I've got a car now. God has blessed me so much this year, and then I reflect and I look back and I see the big picture. I had to go through those things. I had to go through all those things in order to get where I am today, because my relationship with, with God and my foundation from being with Miss Ann and all the Bible studies and all the church. I was like a baby Christian, you know, when I was baptized, and I was with her for a long time, but she was teaching me and growing me, and it's just amazing. It's amazing now, and I just want to thank you so much, because my life has been so fruitful. This year is just filled with blessings, and the waiting is hard, but the waiting came through for me, and I'm just so glad to be here. Thank you for letting us come.
Okay, you are going to have to bear with me. This is the first time I've ever shared this part of my testimony, and I don't want to stand here like this because I feel like I should have a script. Okay, so I've been married for 30 years of my life. Me and my husband met when I was 14, he was 17. I'm 48 now. So, and for the last, I'm trying to cry. For the last 10 years, he's been addicted to pornography. And because I love him so much, I was willing to do whatever he wanted me to do for his affection, which caused bitterness and anger and shame and sorrow in my life. I prayed that God would deliver me from the situation. And I ended up with Miss Ann. At Miss Ann's, we don't need anything. When I got there, I had the clothes on my back from jail. I didn't have anything. I have more clothes than I have room to put them. I don't need anything. I don't need anything. Do you hear me? I don't need toothpaste. I don't need a toothbrush. I don't need hairspray. I don't need no makeup. She provides everything that we need. But more than that, because we can be still in her house, God has shown me that I don't have to do anything to be loved. I don't have to look a certain way. My hair doesn't have to be a certain way. I don't have to have a face full of makeup or high heels on my feet. He loves me just the way I am. And I pray for my husband. I pray with all my heart he comes back to Jesus. Please lift him up. His name is Neil. And I pray he comes back to Jesus, but if he don't, it is okay with me, because I know that I am okay, and I am created for him and for his glory, and I know that his plans for me are good, and I intend to walk in them in Jesus' name. So because of Precious and Pink, I am discovering who I am, who God created me to be, and I don't need anybody. Nobody to convince me or to tell me who I am, because Jesus says I am worthy and I am His, and that's all I need. Amen. Thank you.
I've been saved and baptized, and I know in God's time
He will help me build and mend my relationships with my babies. My mom and I are building a better relationship every day. She is proud of me for the first time. I've made a lot of mistakes, but I know today I am forgiven. I'm thankful for Miss Ann, Precious and Meek, and for a new life. Thank you.
The true friends that did help me had God in their life,
And I ended up in the hospital with some health issues and then nowhere to go. Then a best friend from high school reached out. She's in ministry, and her husband and father-in-law are preachers. Y'all see how God works? She got me to say his phone number, and then my best friend from high school's brother-in-law, they put me up in a hotel. Their whole family prayed for me, and I was able to get in touch with Miss Ann that next morning. She answered the phone on the first ring. She didn't know what she was doing or getting into. But she was there to pick me up without a question by 11 a.m. checkout time. So I'm not one that came from the jail. I'm the stray. That's what we call it, because the hotel was the pound, and she came and got brought me home. But her ministry and what she does is truly, truly God's work. And I've been in her house now for almost 4 months. I built a foundation with Jesus Christ, and I finally have a relationship with my Heavenly Father, and it gets stronger every day. And I know as long as I keep Him first, everything else in my life will fall into place. I've had so many blessings and victories in just 4 months. I can't wait to see my life again. So I'm being obedient to God for the first time ever. My mom, bless her heart, calls me Jonah. She's always like, okay, Jonah, you've been in the belly of that whale for 25 years. When are you going to get out and do what God is telling you to do?
Amen.
That's my other right. And she's right. You know, I love my mom so much. She lives in Idaho, so she's not able to be here. But I write poetry. I have for a very long time. But today I give God the glory. It's a God-given talent. They are His words. I just make them rhyme. But today my poetry tells His story. God has put it on my heart to write my poetry book. So, because I met Miss Ann, I'm able to focus on that and do that. That's my place of solitude, where I am learning who I am. And it's just been the most amazing, amazing experience in my life. But when I'm finished, I hope that my book will help people that are lost, broken, or that have been through what I've been through. And I hope I can put it back into the prisons I came out of. So tonight, I wrote Miss Ann a poem, and I had the experience of reading it. Also, and telling a little bit of my testimony, at the Gather, the Women's Conference, and it was in front of 700 women, for the very, very first time ever. And it was the most freeing thing I've ever done. So, Miss Ann is our shepherd, and we are all her little black sheep.
Yes.
So, this poem I wrote for her is titled Miss Ann. A teacher of the word, a mother to her own, one we can all trust, a mother's love to all is shown. You must learn from her, my father said, she's mine. A strong Christian woman, by her actions, she's defined. She finds the weeping lost, she helps bend the broken. She wants us to love Jesus, her soft, gentle words that are spoken. She has a part in many hearts, with help from the Lord above. She covers us with protection like the wings of a dove. She goes in confined places just to spread the good news. She hopes to lead us to righteousness away from worldly views. She doesn't want the credit, but she so deserves the right. It's God working through her so we can shine Jesus' light. She's touched so many women and planted so many seeds. She's full of love and patience, not hate, bitterness, or greed. She just wants us to make it, and she teaches with Jesus we can. We see her as our angel. We know her as Miss Ann.
We're all black sheep, every one of us, you included. included, whether one admitted or not. We are all black sheep. I am still going to the jail every Tuesday night. I have 7 to 8. The second and fourth Saturday, I go back to the jail from 9 to 10. And if they'll wake up, then I have a group on Saturday mornings. I love going to jail. There's something about being locked up in that room with those women that just blesses my heart. It's really hard to go in there. One of the things that really impressed me early on, and I still see it today, is just looking in their faces and seeing that there's no hope. They have no hope. You know, you can't live without hope. We all have to have it, hope and something. And there's not much hope in that jail. You know, but the most of it is, I hope they don't go to prison. Well, I have bad news for them. Some of them are going. It happens. But like Laura, bless Laura's little heart, I call it inmate.com. That's what she calls it. Inmate.com said she wouldn't be there long, that she don't have to stay a few months, and she'd be getting out. I said, Laura, you're going to be there a year. I work for attorneys. You're going to be there a year? No. They're telling me 3 months. She was there a year. Just like I told her. She would call me crying. I can't do this. I'm like, well, what's your, what else you going to do? Break out? I'm like, you're kind of stuck there. You're going to be okay. You know, anybody that knows me, what do I say? It's going to be okay. Because you know what? It is going to be okay. No matter what. If you got Jesus, it's going to be okay. And Laura was okay, and she came out better on the other side. Amen. And she went in. And I'm thankful for Laura. She's seen a lot of victories over the last few years. You know, it was scary for me when she decided to move out, because I wasn't sure she was ready, but I don't ever know if they're ready. I always assume they're not, because I just want to keep them there where I can make sure they're okay, you know. But at some point in time, they have to leave. And there's an opportunity for me to trust God, to know that He's God, and He can take better care of me than I can. And that's a hard place for me to get to sometimes. But I have to get there too. Life is different at my house than what they were used to. They look so sweet, sitting up here going, y'all look sweet. They all look sweet. But once upon a time, their whole lives were chaos and pot stirring. Y'all know what a pot stirrer is? It's a gossip. And somebody likes to stir stuff up. There you go, right there. I never grew up in chaos. I don't live in chaos. I don't like chaos. I like people and quiet. People ask me all the time, tell me something that you need. Peace on earth, goodwill towards me. That's what I want for Christmas. Peace on earth, goodwill towards me. That's all I need. So one of the hardest things for me when they get to the house is to teach them, we're not going to live like that. We're going to live in peace at this house. And you know, I got Betsy, who's 100 feet tall, and she's used to, if something don't go right, I'm gonna take care of it. I don't know, we got into it about something one night, and I told her I was going to punch her in the face. And she was so sweet, she said, I'll bend over. I love them with all my heart. There's not one little piece of my heart that doesn't love them. I've had over 500 women through my house in the last 15 years, and some of them are just not headed as they could be. Wouldn't do right. I've had them smoke crack in my house. I've had them prostitute in my shed. I've had them do some terrible things.
Steal your cars.
Steal my car. Yeah, that comes bad stuff, you know. I still love them. I told the girls, and I'll tell y'all, this is my approach. God put this in my heart. How many of y'all have children? When they put that first baby in your arms in the hospital, when you hold it for the first time, whether you're mother or daddy, what do you feel? All kinds of love and hope for the future, right? Just on all this hope, you see kindergarten graduation and, you know, school and high school graduation and weddings and, you know, grandbabies, and if you're lucky enough, great-grandbabies, you see all these things that you're. As soon as those girls come to my house, that's what I see. I see this little baby that I love and I have hope for. And there's times when I have to do hard things and make them leave. I don't like doing that. I give them many opportunities to do right. I give Laura way more than she deserved. But it's because I have hope for them. God gives us overs and overs and overs. Have you ever screwed up so many times doing the same thing and God finally said, nah, forgive me for that? Never will. That's the way I feel about them. There has to be much forgiveness, much love, much grace. And I have people that don't understand why some of them I don't throw out immediately. But I'm not. I've told them, I don't expect when you walk in my front door to suddenly be healed from all the bad behavior. This is not going to happen. We don't have to teach our children how to steal a cookie out of a cookie jar or how to tell a lie. We have to teach them not to. And you have to be consistent in doing it. Same thing with them. And if they're not at the house, I can't. I can't keep telling them, you can't do that. It's an ongoing process every day. But it's something I'm so thankful that I get to do. I told y'all I didn't have bad parents. That's my brother back here in the back video and all this. Mm-hmm. And we grew up in a good home. You know, he and I were great kids.
I was.
Sweetest things that I ever remember. But I feel somebody's job. It's your job. Well, God didn't call me to do that. I had this sweet lady in my Sunday school class one time. She starts telling me how much she admired me for doing this. I said, don't admire me. She said, I can't do it. I said, don't admire me. You can do it. She didn't talk to me for 6 months. I didn't care. So let me tell you something. We are all called. You know? I didn't know I could do this either. I didn't think I could.
But God.
But God. God has a way and a plan. And I can do it. He doesn't call us to do the things that are comfortable, that we think are going to be easy because we're already gifted or talented and able to do that. He calls you to do the stuff you don't want to do or that you're uncomfortable doing.
Sorry.
Is it comfortable for me to do this? No. Is it comfortable for them? No. I try to make it as uncomfortable for them as possible. And I mean that in a good way. But it's not comfortable for me every day. Sometimes I want to just run out the front door screaming. But somebody wants it or something. And I can't.
The alarm goes off.
Thank you.